Joining me today, Mayor Savita Vaidhyanathan. Mayor Vaidhyanathan was elected to the Cupertino City Council in 2014. She ran on the platform to support youth, seniors, and protect the environment. She has been serving as the Cupertino mayor since January 2017. Mayor Vaidhyanathan is Cupertino City's first Indian American mayor. She holds an MBA degree from San Jose State University. She worked with women entrepreneurs before becoming a nonprofit consultant. She's also a De Anza College Commissioner and has served as a member of board of West Valley Community Services and president of the Rotary Club of Cupertino. Mayor Vaidhyanathan, thanks for coming down to ST World Affairs.
Thank you for inviting me, Sanjeev. Happy to be here.
You become a mayor in 2017.
Yes.
Why do you think Cupertino City residents, they elected you to become a city council member and then a mayor?
The year I ran, I think there were about eight people running, and we were running for two seats, or maybe there were three seats. It was a very tough election year, and what I can say is probably my message was very simple. As you mentioned in your opening, I had a very simple message to the residents saying I want to run for the youth, for the environment, for the seniors. And I felt these were the three parts of our community that keeps getting neglected. And I felt throwing light on that was important. And I felt no matter what, we have to have a better environment, we leave a better planet for our youth, and it's better for all of us overall.
Okay. So can you share some example, what exactly you are doing for as far as the youth programs?
So for the youth, one of the things, I go to everything that I'm invited when the youth invite me. Mm-hmm. Girls in government, boys in government, girls that put together events, I go there and I inspire as many girls and boys as I can. And I'm seeing it as making a big difference because I'm seeing more students approaching me, wanting to be part of the community in different ways, whether they want to volunteer or whether they want to be a part of the politics. And it has opened doors for them, which they hadn't thought about before. The other thing that we are trying to do is we are trying to coordinate with the school district, our high school district. So the city and the high school district will coordinate to put together a high school incubator program for these students. And it would be something in lines of what you again said in your opening statement about women entrepreneurs, mm-hmm. something similar for youth entrepreneurs.
Okay, and who is funding this incubator?
So it will be a combination of the school district and the city of Cupertino, okay. More from the city of Cupertino.
Okay, so let's talk about environment. This is
yes.
a subject, it's your favorite subject. You talk about it and you are championing environmental thing. So Cupertino City, and I would say next couple of months, Apple campus will mm-hmm. be opening very soon. And then when you talk about, I have some numbers here, the stretch interstate 280 from East San Jose to Cupertino has been named the third worst in Bay Area in the morning time commute. So this traffic congestion, and then of course that impacts the climate.
Yes, doubt
about
absolutely.
It, the pollution and everything. What's your solution to tackle these traffic issues?
So one of my other roles is I'm also a member of the board of VTA, Valley Transport Authority. And we are trying to work on solutions for our highway interchanges as well as mass transit on 85. And hoping to have those solutions soon. Thanks to the Santa Clara County residents, we passed Measure B. And that's a big, big influx of funds that will come towards them, about nine programs that will help towards solutions for traffic and encouraging more people to take mass transit.
Yeah, that's one of the solutions is that.
Yes.
In the Bay Area, when I commute my own car, but again, when it comes to public transportation compared mm-hmm. to other city, other countries, we need to do a lot in terms of mass transportation. Right. So do you think that there'll be more frequency of buses, more frequency of trains?
Again, we are hoping that the Caltrain electrification will happen soon. And I would like the public to write to your representatives in Congress and remind them that Caltrain electrification is really important for all of us. And get more of our residents to use that. So Caltrain will definitely help with some of the traffic. And when you're asking about frequency of buses, VTA is currently going through a planning process called the Next Network, which will actually take away some buses, but increase the frequency of others. So they're trying to increase the frequency where there is more traffic, and encouraging especially our youth to use that transport, and also encouraging people who are, say, in South San Jose, to if they want to commute to Mountain View, like here, to take the bus, okay. Express buses.
Sure. So when we talk about Cupertino and the attraction of the Cupertino is the best, one of the best public schools, no doubt about mm-hmm. it. But that has created another problem. I'm going to run through some data here that, okay. according to U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, a family of four living in Santa Clara County, where mm-hmm. Cupertino is, the low-income threshold is approximately $85,000, yes. right? And when you talk about the housing and rental prices in Cupertino, studio rental, it's around $1,500. Mm-hmm. One-bedroom, $2,500. Two bedrooms, approximately $3,000, and three bedroom, $4,000, approximately. How do you bring the balance here, the growth versus a rental affordability to a residents of Cupertino?
So one of the things that our council, city council, is really focused on is bringing affordable housing to the community. And when we have other developers bringing proposals, the impact fee from those developments is significantly high, so we set aside funds for affordable housing. And it's a complicated formula where you have funds from different groups and that you put together and make an affordable housing project. And there's something called CDBG funding, which is community development block grants, which, like you said, it's the HUD that grants to us. So that is, again, given to the nonprofits. And with a formula matching, we put together a project that is for affordable housing. But it's very difficult to come by a parcel where we can do that. So we're trying to encourage inclusionary housing, which means within an existing project, a percentage make it affordable. And it's more likely to get that when the development is for sale units rather than for rental units. Because in the state of California, there was a law, it so happened that we cannot require the developers to increase the number of affordable housing units if it's rental. There are some laws in place that prevent us from requiring that.
Okay. So the solution which you are proposing that Cupertino City will build more affordable housings, do we have enough space here?
So that's what we're saying. It has to be inclusionary. Not be a standalone project. We are going to hope to see a standalone project for senior affordable very soon. And we are hoping that'll go through. It's going to come to our planning commission very soon. We are hoping that'll be a big success.
Okay. So this is going to be a affordable housing, or housing for rental, or housing for you can buy and purchase that. If you look at the housing itself, the median household value in Cupertino is $1.8 million, mm-hmm. right?
Single family home,
right? So people who don't want to buy a house and they just want to rent it, is that something this program will support that? Or it just you need to just buy the house?
No, so like I was saying, affordable housing for rental, that market is very, very difficult to encourage our developers to make that. Mm-hmm. We keep asking them to voluntarily do because like I said earlier, we cannot require it. But when it comes to housing units which are on sale, there is a percentage mm-hmm. that we can require and it needs to be done. So when it is owner-occupied, we can actually have a percentage set aside for affordable.
Right. And this problem is not only Cupertino. This is all over the Bay Area.
It's all over the Bay Area. Some cities have the luxury of more land. Mm-hmm. We are almost built out, mm-hmm. so there isn't much left to build on to have a large parcel of land.
Right. So talking about the land, let's just talk about this Valco shopping district development, right? So walk us through the Measure C and Measure D, what happened, and Cupertino residents, they rejected these measures, mm-hmm. and what's happening? Do you have any update on that?
So the update is just as fresh as last night's city council meeting. We now have a process in place to educate our residents on what the current status of retail in the country is, mm-hmm. what affordable housing is, and how exactly can affordable housing be built. Because like I explained to you earlier, not everyone understands how you get an affordable housing development put together. Mountain View has been very successful in doing that. And the third portion would be about how to, again, the question that you asked earlier, how do we tackle traffic, mm-hmm. especially once Apple Campus comes online? How do we find solutions for all three of these issues?
Right, because I do get many emails that now people who know that I'm going to interview you, and they already asked me a few questions, and people who are living across this Wolf Street, I mean, they are extremely concerned that all of a sudden 12,000, approximately that's the yes. campus capacity, this 12,000 Apple employees will rush into peak hours. How it's going to, how Cupertino, is Cupertino City ready for this kind of traffic congestion? I mean, that's what it is. I mean, that there are many questions and concerns. It comes out in my email box, and I just want to talk about that.
Which is a completely legitimate question. We already have congestion there, not from Apple, because we have people passing through the city. They are avoiding the freeways, and they are taking the artery streets. And what's happening is that you have that traffic also. With in specifically with Apple, we are requesting, and this is something that was talked about with the council that was in seat in, I think it was 2011 when the proposal came through, and they were asked to reduce their single occupancy vehicles. Mm-hmm. So that is now at 34%. In the current Apple campus, which is on Infinite Loop, it's 28%. So we are asking them to reduce it further, that is, have more people commute mm-hmm. and have lesser people coming in their single occupancy vehicles. And of course, everybody knows they're doing the corporate buses, encouraging more people to bike. Cupertino is spending a lot of money on our bike transportation plan. And that is something we are hoping to have, a bike boulevard on Stevens Creek, which will help people take the bicycles instead of being in their cars, and hopefully find some solutions to the issue of traffic.
So it sounds like City of Cupertino has well thought about this.
We are very engaged, and we constantly are in contact with the engineers at Apple, and they are phasing their employees in. Mm-hmm. It'll be over a period of 6 to 8 months. They said that they were beginning in the month of April, so they should probably have already commenced. And they'll slowly see the uptick in traffic and come back to us and let us know how it's been functioning so far.
So why do you think, just change of topic, why do you think Cupertino public school systems are better than rest of the, I know that in terms of Palo Alto, Cupertino, and Fremont, the schools are better, and but the rest of the Bay Area, really, when you compare against the rest of the country, the school systems are, they need to do a little bit better job. So why do you think people are coming to Cupertino for, of course, the schools are better, but why do you think is that, is there any reasons? Good funding, good
definitely
teachers?
Definitely not good funding. Yeah. If you ask a school district official, they'll tell you that right. we are not, it's completely based on basic aid, and the high school district is on property tax. But I would say it's a combination of our teachers, our parents, and our students. The students are self-motivated. They really want to do well, and the parents, of course, are constantly encouraging their young ones. And the combination of having really good teachers is a formula for success.
Okay, that's good enough. You are being first Indian American mayors. Tell us about your success story. How did you reach to this high?
Can I ask a question? Are most of your viewers of Indo origin?
I think our viewers are mixed. But especially for this program, we are going to reach all the way to India, okay. no doubt about it. But I think most of our viewers are YouTube goers.
Okay.
They would like to see it. So definitely we want to send out a message here about your success story, how
okay.
did you reach this high. So that's why I think it's very important for us, our viewers, to know that, okay, you are an Indian American mayor, no doubt about it, City of Cupertino, and what's your success story?
So the reason I asked is I was going to say something in Sanskrit, but I will also explain what it is
okay.
in English.
Yeah.
It's karmanya vadhikaraste. That's been my philosophy throughout life. I do my deed, I do not look for the result, and I never have. So when I got involved in the community, I've been doing different things. You mentioned it at the beginning of the program. I was on the board of West Valley. I joined the De Anza Commission. I also a very active member of the Rotary Club of Cupertino. And I do other things which don't have a name attached to it. I just help in the community. It gives me great pleasure because the way I see it, I live in this community. The more I give back, the more my community is successful. And it was as simple as that. I wasn't really checking the boxes to run for political office.
Right.
But after a few years, people saw me in different places and they say, why aren't you actually getting yourself a title? And I said, I never thought about that. And I ran. And that's the story.
So what do you think you have challenges ahead of you? I mean, what are the challenges you can think about right now? Looking at your background, you were in corporate world, and then you went to nonprofit world, and now you are running the city.
The biggest challenge in our city is definitely housing and transportation. And it's two sides of the same coin. I say it's H for housing and T for transportation, heads and tails. And together we have to find some solutions. And if we don't, we will be in really deep trouble. And on the edges environment.
Okay. So as far as the all these issues you have it right now, are you equipped with good resources? As far as the funding and the resources, do you have enough experts in, on your side to solve all these problems, environmental, educations, transportations? And are you well equipped with that? I mean, is Cupertino City in what? So you have been in Cupertino mayor for the last 4 months, five months. Have you learned anything which gave you some kind of surprises that, oh, this is Cupertino City, we require more funding, more public support, more engagement with the community? What have you learned?
Definitely more engagement with the community, because there are things that are there in social media which are incorrect, and it would be nice if the public got the information from the city. So that is one of the things I realized, that people get, it's exactly like what's happening at the national level. There's one news item that takes everyone's attention, and then that takes a life of its own. So definitely having community engagement in the right way is very, very important. As far as funding goes, we have funding sources are sales tax, property tax, and our business taxes. That's what funds our city. And thankfully, Cupertino is doing quite well. We do have our challenges. We have all kinds of demands on those taxes, but we try to keep a balanced budget quite healthy.
So now, Cupertino City, when I look at, I don't have Census Bureau official data, but my observation is that a Chinese and Indian community, quite their mood on that area. So what's your message here, people, especially immigrant community, and there is a kind of blind rush to come down to Cupertino again because of the schools.
Yes.
But then housing affordability, it kind of stops there. It's kind of check and balance, right?
Yes.
So how do you, so what's your message to immigrant community who wants to come down to Cupertino City, but there are not enough housing, right? And there are not enough space also in school also, right? I mean, so how do you balance this? People who wants to come down to Cupertino City, but you don't have enough space and school space in school also.
We have about, our population is around 64,000, and it's about a third. So about more than 60% is a combination of Chinese and Indo immigrants. And as you said, it's because of the schools that we have those families. They value education, and they want to be in those neighborhoods so that they can send their kids to public schools. Until and unless we build more affordable housing, this will continue to be an issue. Single family homes, there are only so many that come up for sale. There are only so much that come up for rent. So it's there is no easy fix. Any band-aid would be maybe having a smaller apartment on a smaller scale, but not any big size project until and unless something happens with Valco.
Yeah, the Valco is the biggest one right now.
Yes, and we still don't know what our residents want. We know what they don't want, but we still don't know whether they want to have some residential there. And if they want residential, what kind of residential? So that's why I talked about the process of education. So once the community is educated in what are the various things that go into a mixed-use parcel, it'll be very good to hear back from them and say, okay, this is what I would like to see in my city, and this is what I just don't want in my city. So that's where we are at, that balance point.
Okay. So let's just talk about this small businesses who want to survive in Cupertino. Like we just now talked about, the threshold is like $84,000, $85,000. That considers a low income for a single family with four kids. So small businesses, how do they survive? How do you bring balance to them also? Again, there are no space. Again, we are going back to the same issue.
Yes.
There are no space available. And then housing affordability and everything. How do small businesses survive in Cupertino?
So one of the things, again, we are looking at is an economic development strategic program. And with through that, we are hoping to repurpose some space into incubator space so that newer, smaller businesses can occupy those and utilize the spaces, which a big corporate office would not want anyway, and have a small business use that and grow their business there. That's one of the things we are really encouraging and hoping to see happening sometime soon. And then there are certain retail portions of our city which are slowly not being occupied as much as they were. Maybe the front end is being occupied, but the back end not so much. This was all built several years ago when the requirements were different. So we may want to repurpose those spaces and see if we can have some incubator spaces there for the small businesses. And that's what we are looking to see by the end of this year.
Okay. So this incubator which we are proposing, is that something, again, the funding will be self-funded, or it's going to be something the large corporation will help help out here? I mean, how it's going to be done? I mean, or you, or city, Cupertino City will have some mandate that, okay, these are the buildings which is meant for small businesses, and large corporations like Apple, Google,
yes,
they cannot come after that.
That's what we are hoping to do. That's exactly what we are hoping to rezone this the area so that only a small business will be excited about coming there, and the large business will not.
Okay.
And that's the only way we can encourage the entrepreneur to start their businesses locally.
Okay. So what do you, and just a final question, what do you want or what do you expect from the community so that in next coming years you become successful mayor of Cupertino? What do you expect from a community as a give back?
I would love for them to volunteer in different parts of the community and help the community grow. And you said many of them wrote to you. I would love it if they wrote to me and told me what they felt and what they wanted to see. And I'm very, very happy to meet with them and hear whatever they want to talk about. Mm-hmm. Because a group of happy residents makes the community happy and successful, and we'll grow well together.
And how do people can touch base with you? Is it the website?
The City of Cupertino website. You go to the City Council page. You'll see my name, picture, and an email address. Click on it. It'll come to me.
Okay.
The
email
will come to me.
Anything you want to, I said last question. Maybe this is the last question. Any problems which you want to talk to us, which haven't spoken, or I haven't asked you any questions, which you do want to communicate with directly to Cupertino residents, which you have not communicated yet?
To people in general, depending on who your audience is, and we got a feel for who they are. I feel that people spend a lot of time on national issues, which you really cannot do much about. And armchair politics about what's happening in the country of origin, again, you can't do much about that. What you can affect and influence is local politics. You don't like something in your neighborhood, you can affect changes there. Your child wants a park with benches which is more suited for the grandmom to sit on. Then the child can actually make the effort happen because they can go to a Parks and Recs Commission meeting and say, this is not ideal, please see what you can do to fix it. If a roof is leaking in one of the park facilities, again, you can make effect change by bringing that up to the council and the commissions. So I will say engage in local politics, engage in what's needed in your community, and that will make life better for everyone.
Okay. Mayor Vaidhyanathan, thank you very much for coming on to our show. And hopefully you will come one more time when we invite you, hopefully next year.
Thank you so much for inviting me, and I really hope to be back. It was a pleasure.
Thanks.
Thank you, Sanjeev.